why we are Lata, I mean Lata Ananta and Parmita Tandri, you'll find two names over here. Actually, this is a small history to this. Since 4 or 5 years, we have been thinking of how to address dams at a large, how we should be looking at our rivers, how we should be managing our rivers with a futuristic perspective. Because now we are looking and managing our rivers with a very short-term perspective. And because rivers are eternal and rivers have to flow, so we were thinking it's very important that we take this message across to all the movements, activists, the bureaucracy, the government, including the local governments who are working on using the rivers, and how we should be looking at river, how differently we should be looking at a river instead of the compartmentalized sectoral manner in which we are looking at the rivers now. So that's how the idea of a primer on environment flows was born. And international rivers, of course, with help from friends like Samir Mehta, he agreed that, okay, we can all work together, let us see what happens, and let us take this primer to as many places as possible. So of course, we have already had a workshop in Guwahati for the all those 168 plus dams that are coming up, including the Brahmaputra, Teesta, all the other basins, which are, I mean, what to do with them, how do we look at the future development and management and restoration of basins in the Northeast. So we thought a similar exercise is necessary in the Uttarakhand, in the Western Himalayan context. Of course, most of what we are going to share with you is nothing new, and you would be already aware of it. We have just tried to put together, based on our own experience and what a few concepts, and including the level of implementation, challenges, the legal and policy implications of environment flows. So now this presentation, hopefully, because both Sanita and me we are not good at managing time, but hopefully we will finish it within our 45 minutes. I will be speaking a little bit, followed by Parnita, and then I'll take over. That's how we are going to build our sequence. I will just start with a bit of provocation or provocative statement, because this is a very recent statement by our Honorable Minister Jayanti Nadarajan, especially pertaining to Ganga, that all hydro projects on the Ganga should be asked to reduce their power generation, possibly up to 50% of their capacity. And one is not very clear, one assumes that it is installed capacity, but possibly up to 50% of capacity for what? Because now the ministry believes in the clean and continuous flow of the river's water. And also, very important statement is, the ministry is exploring the legality of reducing the capacity of the existing hydroelectric projects, especially 17 hydroelectric projects which are already operating in the Ganga basin. And so this is a statement which some of us were discussing. And of course, based on RTI, and we know about 680 dams are being planned in the entire Ganga basin. And I mean, and now that is which is under the scanner is the Alaknanda Bhagirathi basin. And so in this context, the minister's statement, I think, holds very good value, in the sense, according to me, it is not about environment flows, but this is the first steps towards restoring flows in damaged rivers. Because one of the ways by which we can strategize, we can operate restoring flows in damaged rivers. And but why? Why are we so concerned about flows nowadays? Why are we so concerned? Because all this is something which I am not going to repeat before you. But you take any river basin in the country, we all know there is not even a single river basin which has not been touched by humans. We cannot say any river basin is pristine. In terms of deforestation, we know almost all rivers have been affected. But maybe in terms of dams or industries or thermal or mining, there are variations in which rivers have been affected or not affected. But certain things which are very common that are emerging in the context of almost most of our river basins in the country, because most of those rivers which have been dammed, I have a lot of experience in the Western Ghats, the rivers have been fragmented to that extent that there are no flows between them, especially in the case of river diversions from the in the Western Ghats, from the west flowing rivers divert to the eastern side. This happened in the Krishna, in the Kaveri, in the Periyar, in the Chalakudi. All these river basins, we have these experiences where there is absolutely no flow for 38 kilometers, 40 kilometers. And the rivers in the Western Ghats are very, very tiny when you compare with the larger rivers in the Himalayas or in the peninsula. Of course, we know Karachi stands inside the Indus, in the delta of the Indus basin. From 1892 to the 1990s, there's been a drastic flow reduction from 1,85,000 MCM, million cubic meter, to 12,300 MCM per annum. And this has been clearly stated because of reduced flows into the delta. And at least the salinity intrusion has been 64 kilometers into the river, and it is 1.2 million acres of farmland. I mean, we can, it's not about data alone. It is about how each and every river basin is gradually going into a closing basin, in which because the extraction of water is much more when compared to the amount of water left in the river for the river to perform its different functions, and because of which outfalls are falling more and more over the years. And in Krishna, because in the 2004 drought year, we know 2004 was a drought year, the outfalls from Krishna into the sea on the Bay of Bengal were almost zero. It was recorded. So where are we heading? In Yamuna, though comprehensive study of Yamuna basin has not been carried out, there are no freshwater flows downstream of Tajiwala up to Etawah, a considerable stretch where the Chambal River meets the Yamuna, because at least during the lean month. And this is happening in many of our rivers, dammed or even no dammed, because of many other reasons. And because that's what I would like to say, but I would like to state over here that dams, of course, they are the most important, most direct, and sometimes most often irreversible modifiers of dam flow. Because they block the flow, they fragment the river, they put the river into compartments between the reservoirs, they regulate the flows. And in the language of environment flows, the timing, the magnitude, the volume of water, the duration, and the frequency. So these are the four important changes which are brought about by flow alteration created by dams. Deforestation is one of them, which has a long historical legacy, British and even before British, especially in the context of the Northeast as well as the Himalayan rivers, we know the ecosystems, the ecology is very fragile. Already there is a history of deforestation, and now we are building dams. So what is the accumulated impact? Already deforestation, landslide prone areas, seismic areas, and we are actually adding by building more and more number of dams. And are we factoring all these aspects into that? The impact of deforestation. And then comes mining, because in the Western Ghats rivers, and also in the, we know in Orissa and all this is happening already, many of the river basins, the catchments, the upper catchments, are so heavily mined. The flows have been diverted, the flows are polluted, even small streams which originate from these, the Western Ghats parts in the Goa, they are all filled up, silted up because of the mining catchments. And this also alters the flows, the quality of water is affected, and who will supply drinking water, the basic needs to the people who are living around the mining areas. In fact, one of our friends, Ritwik Datta, all of you must be, what we are trying to do now is in Goa, evidence, building evidence for how mining is affecting water bodies, how mining is affecting the stream flows. Then sand mining, as we all know, sand mining is happens in the lower down areas in a river, immediately after the river leaves the mountains. But sand mining is something which increases the gradient, it increases the flow. So what happens is the quality and as well as the quantity of the flow in turn affecting the aquatic organisms and their breeding. And so sand mining also adds to the quantity and quality and the flow fluctuation that happens in the river. Pollution, of course, I did not talk about it. And the latest, we are now into the Rio discussions. So I'm just trying to take you through some images just to show this is one of the largest dams in the Kerala Western Ghats. And the entire river, this is the Periyar River, the Idukki Arch Dam, one of the wonders, considered one of the wonders. And below the dam, it's an arch dam. So the river is completely diverted, and after power generation, the river enters into another river. And in that river, there is daily flood because of the water from this river is also transported to that river after power generation. So below Idukki, for about 15-20 kilometers, there is no river. Again, one more dam. And upstream of this is the Mullaperiyar, which is very important because Mullaperiyar dam is something which all of you have been now reading in the newspapers. Supreme Court has intervened, it's an interbasin diversion. And above this reservoir for 38 kilometers, again the flows are not there. So Periyar is almost a dam fragmented river up to about 70-80 kilometers out of its 244 kilometers length. So where is the river left there? So this question, I think tomorrow in the Northeast or in the Uttarakhand region, if all the dams and all get built, we'll have to ask this question, where are the rivers? Of course, just to show, how deforestation, this is a story everywhere. Wherever we have forests and where deforestation, all the summer flows are affected in such rivers. And these summer flows, of course, have to contribute tomorrow to the in-stream flow into the reservoirs. So where is the summer flow for contributing into the in-stream of the reservoirs? and we are having a lot of target for installed capacities for each of these hydropower projects that are in the pipeline. So briefly, what are the implications of regulation of loads? When we bring variations in the quantity, in the quality, in the magnitude, in the timing, what happens to a river? I'm not going to, because this is something which I'm sure all of you are aware of, but this is what happens. Like Ravi Chopra ji was rightly pointing it out, we look at a river from only an engineering perspective. This much flows is there. We have a dam design, we have a dam site. So this much flows can be used for generating this much amount of power. But what is happening to the river? Once all these dams or once the flows are regulated, ecological, morphological, hydraulic, the lateral, the longitudinal connectivity gets lost. And the impact of the ecological, morphological and hydraulic connectivity, its implications are leading to a lot of social issues, because many of the rivers, inland fishing is disappearing, the fish diversity is disappearing. Of course, yesterday we were talking about, we have some amount of studies carried out by institutions on the fish diversity, but we have absolutely no studies what's happening to the habitat. What is the connection between the changes in the riparian ecosystem and the fish, as well as the other feeding and the breeding and the nutrient deposit that takes place in the river, how it changes when more and more dams and more changes happen to the ecology of the river. And of course, all this impacts the economy, because local livelihoods are affected, not only local livelihoods. I know in the Kerala there are 966 panchayats, right from the upstream panchayats to the downstream panchayats. All these 966 panchayats, they depend on external supply of potable drinking water during summer. And we are supposed to have 44 small rivers. So where is the connection getting lost? Why are these panchayats depending upon potable water for the summer water requirement, when there is so much water available, so much rainfall available in the state? So where is the connection getting lost? According to me, this loss of connection, this loss of trying to connect the ecology, the morphology and the climate and the human interventions that we are doing in the rivers, this connection we are losing somewhere, and we are ending up doing many of the wrong things. And especially, I'm not dwelling more in the spiritual and cultural aspects, because Ravi Chopra ji has already deliberated a lot upon it. But of course, in the context of the Western Ghats, sacred groves, temple fish sanctuaries, which also have relevance over here in a different context. But these were, as he was rightly pointing out, for Kaveri, for example, in the Western Ghats, you have a Talak Kaveri, which is a temple. For Narmada, you have Amarkantak. For all these, it's because of the sanctity. I would not call it religious. It's because of the spiritual sanctity we have given to our rivers. And this is a classic example in the Western Ghats. I'm just showing this because what is in store for, I was in Sikkim 2 or 3 weeks back. Sikkim is a land of waterfalls. I'm sure those of you know Sikkim. And I was wondering what will happen to these waterfalls if many of the rivers in Sikkim get dammed. Because we already have examples of the Jog Falls, yesterday Samir was saying it's a Jog Falls. Now it has become a Jog Falls because it's a joke. Yeah, it's a big joke. Because in 1964, a dam was built about 15 kilometers upstream of the Jog Falls, and after that, Jog Falls is the pride of South India and the Western Ghats. One of the biggest waterfalls, one of the most visited waterfalls in the Western Ghats, is now a trickle. And if you want to see water like the Raja Rani Falls, as they are called, then you have to approach the dam agency and the Karnataka Power Board. They have to open the penstock, then the water will be released. And when they will close the penstock. Because in summer, what is more important? Power generation is more important. Meeting the peaking demand is more important. The matter that for 30 kilometers the river is not flowing, or see, you can see that is a Sharavati below the waterfalls. So that's not an issue for. And so what I'm just talking about, the paradises that are going to be lost. So we have already lost a lot of paradise in the many of the rivers which we have intervened beyond the, what you say, repair. But there are paradises to be lost, because we know that when you come to the Himalayas, very complex, passing through different geoclimatic zones. So the Himalaya itself, I know, all of you know better than me, passes through three or four different types of geoclimatic geographical zones till it reaches and joins the Brahmaputra, the Sundarbans, and flows. One can't imagine how, I mean, the Ganga, it's not only because of the national river, more than that, the type of the river, the dimension of that river, the dimension for the one huge landscape, for the entire population living there, for all the different states which depend upon it, for all the different countries that depend upon it. So now this is what we are going to make of the most of the important tributaries in Ganga, and once they are going to be, if they are going to be dammed. So what would be the impact on Assam? What would be the impact in the floodplains of Ganga, in the floodplains of Brahmaputra? What would be the impact if all the upstream catchments are going to be dammed and the river is going to flow more through tunnels than through its natural course? So what is going to be the fertility of the floodplains? What is going to happen to the people who have been living there for centuries depending on these rivers? So it's very important, because all these years since independence, since our 5-year plans, we have been following the dictum, water flows waste to the sea. So every drop of water has to be used for humans alone, whatever industries or dams or whatever it is. So that dictum we have been following, and but we are posing another question before you. According to us, is river an ecosystem in itself, or is it a river of drain? How should we be looking at the river? So according to us, a river is an ecosystem in itself, and perhaps a river is the only ecosystem which is capable of connecting all the different ecosystems from the mountain to the sea, which is capable of connecting, which is capable of linking up the different ecological diversity of all the different ecosystems: forests, riparian forests, then floodplains, mangroves, all the different ecosystems within our land, wetlands, and all these connections and later entering into the sea. These are just the glimpses of why a river should flow, and why all these human interventions are going to create a lot of other unforeseen problems in the years down to come. Because we know a river is the only natural entity which is capable of depositing flow sediments, transporting sediments, and which in turn we all depend upon for right up to sand mining. And even the smallest streams originating from the catchments in the Himalayas or the Western Ghats, they have been used by communities for so many years. Malavika is very familiar with this, and how flowing river is used for as livelihood. I need to explain this to you. And this is something which touched me because we have been, some of us have come together to do a comprehensive study of the Tista Basin at a transboundary level. But what touched me a lot is this small prayer wheel in a small remote village in Sikkim, and almost all villages have this. And there, a stream emanating from the forest above, it's being used for rotating the prayer wheel. So imagine if the stream stops flowing, it is a spiritual shock for them. Because they believe that as long as the prayer wheel goes on rotating, that means as long as the stream flows. So according to me, flows, whether it's from a smaller stream to a largest huge river basin right down to the floodplain like in the Ganga, and this is actually one of the small streams which will contribute to the Tista Basin, the flows in the Tista Basin. But this is very important. And this community, this village, Lepcha village, which has been here for centuries, they have been conserving the flow, and that means they have been conserving the catchment, and they've been to depend upon this for years and years to come. And many of you, this is a very common scene in the Western Ghats rivers. You find the as soon as the summer comes, as soon as after December, you find all the riparians are up. You don't see the riparian inside the riparian roots inside the river. You see them up, hanging in the air. That it's an indication that the river is flowing much below it should have been flowing. Each flow in a river performs different ecological functions, and these ecological functions together, they are the ones which keep humans like us dependent upon the river, especially these regimes of high, moderate, and low flows is the one that keeps the river in a pure condition, maintaining fresh water flows in the river throughout the year. So coming back to so this is just an example of a regulated tropical river in the Western Ghats, in which we have been working for the last 15 years. It's a regulated tropical river because there are 6 dams. So just see the difference. Before regulation, this was not the scenario in the river. But now, because there are people who have been living in this river even before the dams came, and they have told us that they used to, I mean, about half of this flow, which you find in July, you know, July is the prime monsoon time in Kerala. Half of this flow used to be there in May, a little bit below that. And like Ravi Chopra was saying, there are people living along the riverbank used to say, they used to hear the roar of the river even during summer. But now you can imagine, are you going to hear the roar of the river? So this is the condition of the monsoon versus summer flows now in a regular tropical river. And even if you look at it, even now, there are small anadromous fish which travel, which wait for the water to fall, and they travel up the 45 meter steep fall, I mean the steep. Now goes down to the fundamental thing. So all this time we were talking about what is environment flows. Ideally, I would believe that, the river has rights to all its flows. And Ramaswamy Iyer has been always raising this point, who are we to tamper, decide this much is for nature, this much is for human beings. Of course, it is true. There is no river which carries more water than it can. But we have these assumptions of surplus, deficit. But ideally, a river has a right to all its flows. But in reality, we know that the condition of our rivers, we have intervened so much. There have been interventions like our staying in the dams, diversions and deforestation, sand mining. So much has been carried out. So now it becomes our responsibility to see that the river leaves. So at least some living flows are left in the river. So for what? I mean, for according to me, at least 3 important aspects are there. One is we have to allow most of the rivers, because they are not reaching the sea, the hydrological cycle is completely disrupted. So the river has to complete the hydrological cycle. And through that, the river has to carry out its ecological and evolutionary processes. The river has been there before me and you. It will be there even after you and me. So it has to live on, it has to go on. And through that, because people like us and human beings, we can benefit from the services, the values provided by the ecosystem and by the flows in the ecosystem. I'm not going to the environment flows as, I mean, I would like to look at environment flows in this perspective so that it becomes. So what is the condition of the river? I mean, now we are coming down to the practicalities of it. All this time we were talking about conceptually how we look at flows. So what is the condition of the river we are aspiring for with all these interventions taking place? What is the best flow regime, high flows, low flows we are looking for? What are all the ecological human needs that we have to satisfy? And who will decide?